Welcome to another show of this week. Our first piece is an interview with the Assistant Secretary General of the United Nations Peacekeeping Operations, Ghassim Wane, who has just ended an assessment mission to South Sudan. He spoke to Radio Miraya Sebit William just before he left the country. Here is what he said.
Mr. Ghassim, good morning and welcome to Miraya Breakfast Show.
Good morning and thank you for having me.
Yes, just briefly tell us, what was the purpose of your visit to South Sudan?
This visit is undertaken in pursuance of Resolution 2304, which requested the Secretary General to submit a report on the implementation of the mandate of UNMISS, including the Regional Protection Force, and to make recommendations on how best to adjust UNMISS to the situation on the ground and enhance the efficiency of the implementation of its mandate.
Yes, and as you came, who did you meet and what are some of the key issues that you've discussed?
Well, we met a wide range of South Sudanese stakeholders. We had in-depth exchange of views with a delegation of cabinet members led by the Minister for Cabinet Affairs and including a number of other officials. We met with the Speaker of the Transitional National Legislative Assembly. We met with the Chief Justice. We also undertook field trips to Malakal and Bentiu, and I would like to add that prior to my arrival, we had an advanced team which also met with a wide range of South Sudanese and non-South Sudanese stakeholders.
Yes, and so far, are you happy with the implementation process of the peace agreement, or are you happy with your visit and the outcome of your visit?
Well, we see the opportunity of the visit, of course, to assess the situation. And as I said, to exchange with a wide range of stakeholders, both from South Sudan and from the diplomatic community here in Juba. We discussed a number of issues of common concern linked to the deployment of the Regional Protection Force, which was mandated by the Security Council in Resolution 2304. We discussed issues linked to the freedom of movement for UNMISS and for the humanitarian community. As you know, we face very serious challenges on the ground, and we believe that it is important that every effort be made, that full cooperation be availed to UNMISS and to the humanitarian community to enable them to implement their mandate in support of the people of South Sudan. And the efficiency of the support they can extend depends, of course, on the level of cooperation they receive from the South Sudanese stakeholders. So it's a point we have made to the South Sudanese, to our South Sudanese interlocutors. We emphasize, of course, the urgency of the deployment of the RPF. We also emphasize the importance of continued efforts to ensure an inclusive implementation of the peace process to enable us indeed achieve the peace and security that the people of South Sudan have been yearning for many, many years.
Yes, just recently the government came out, of course, and said they have accepted the deployment of the protection force to South Sudan. Do we know when this will be effective? I mean, when will they be on the ground?
Well, we are working to ensure that the deployment takes place as quickly as possible. As you may know, there are a number of conditions that need to be met and that need to be created to facilitate that process. The government has consented to the deployment. We have some details to resolve, and we hope that those details will be resolved quickly to enable us to proceed with the deployment. And the sooner the force is here, the better we believe, because the force will contribute indeed to creating a better sense of security and helping create conditions for an inclusive implementation of the peace process.
Yes, what happens next after this assessment visit?
What happens, we'll be preparing a report that would inform recommendations by the Secretary General to the Security Council, and then Security Council will take a decision on the matter. As you know, the mandate of UNMISS was extended by Security Council in Resolution 2304 until 15 December. Before that date, of course, a new resolution has to be adopted based on the recommendations that would be put forward by Secretary General.
Mr. Ghassim, what is your final remarks on your visit to South Sudan?
Well, I just would like to say how proud I am of the work being done by our peacekeepers and the humanitarian community in extremely difficult and challenging conditions. You have been to Malakal, I've been to Bentiu, as I indicated, I did visit POC sites here also in Juba, and one could see how challenging the conditions are, how difficult the conditions are, but also how committed and how dedicated our peacekeepers are. I would like also to add that as United Nations, we're committed to helping the people of South Sudan, to working closely with the government and all other South Sudanese stakeholders to help them bring to an end the crisis afflicting their country. South Sudan has suffered so much. The people of South Sudan have suffered so much. It's high time for all South Sudanese stakeholders to truly, genuinely commit themselves to an inclusive peace process to bring to an end the suffering inflicted upon their people.
Mr. Ghassim, thank you so much for coming to me.
While in the country, ASG Wane visited Malakal and Bentiu. Up next, the brief story from Samson Liberty in Malakal.
Welcome, sir.
After his arrival in Malakal, Al-Ghassim, who led a team from the UN headquarters on a strategic assessment of the UN's engagement in South Sudan, sat and listened to some leaders of displaced communities in Malakal. He also held meetings with the officials from UNMISS and other UN agencies on the ground. He and his team also visited a protection of civilians site to see the condition of the displaced.
We met representatives of IDPs and people living in POC sites. And one message I really take from all our meetings is that people want peace, and they want peace like yesterday. And it's an imperative for us, while working to improve their lot, to improve their situation, to do whatever we can, the UN, the AU, IGAD, and the larger international community, to bring about the peace that people are yearning for.
Speaking during the visit, the UN Mission's Deputy Special Representative of the Secretary General, Mustafa Sumari, who accompanied Al-Ghassim, urged the displaced to work hand and glove with the politicians in their search for peace.
It's really what their, as IDP, want, but they have now to work really with the politicians so that they can really make that peace happen. Because at the end of the day, they are the one who can actually make the politician understand that what they want is peace, and make really the politician work towards that peace.
The UN mission in Malakal is hosting to 32,000 displaced. In total, the mission shelters about 202,000 displaced in various locations countrywide. The strategy assessment team is expected to develop a shared understanding of the situation and core priorities to achieve peace and to propose options for United Nations engagement in South Sudan.
In our next piece, a civil society activist has welcomed the move by the government to allow the deployment of a 4,000-strong regional protection force in South Sudan. Speaking on Radio Miraya's Democracy in Action on Monday, Rajab Mohandis, who is the executive director of South Sudanese Network for Democracy and Elections, described the latest development as a positive step. Here is what he said.
Give us your reaction to the move from the government.
We have seen that there is a change in the position of the government to accept the deployment of this force and to cooperate with all necessary institutions, especially UNMISS and the region, so that this force is deployed to South Sudan. So this is a big shift from the initial position that South Sudan would not accept a single soldier on its soil for this purpose of protection.
What triggered this sudden acceptance?
The government, I think, got what it wanted from these protests. First, the force name changed from Intervention Brigade, that's called for by the Council, IGAD Council of Ministers on the 11th of July, to what we have now as Protection Force. This protection force, regional protection force, sounds a little bit mild compared to an intervention brigade. So I think that was an achievement on the side of the government in what it wanted. And then the second change that the government got also to its advantage, I think it was now in terms of the mandate of the force. First, the government said this force should come to protect IDPs, protect humanitarian agencies, and protect GMEC. Number two, the government said this force, the mandate, funding, timing, armament, and the rest should be discussed with or approved by the transitional government of national unity. And the government got this, actually, because if you saw from the latest Peace and Security Council resolution, it has said that this force will be deployed in collaboration with the transitional government.
In this light of these forces that you have, those of the group of Lamakol, of Dr. Riek Machar, who have already declared their own opposition to this visa, I mean, to the government, what is this going to bring? What changes is it going to bring if indeed, when these forces are deployed?
On my side, as a, in particular, I don't put our like hope in getting peace to South Sudan, normalizing the situation in South Sudan on the deployment of this force. What matters so much is how the government will work to reduce the risk of all these threats from the other groups. That is what is so important. The force will have a limited effect, in my own view, on this situation, because this force will be based in Juba. And we have challenges in many parts of the country. We have insecurity in so many different parts of the country that needs to be addressed. So I don't see the force, as important as it may be, I don't see the force now with this changing mandates being able to address this situation all around the country. So there is that that demand from the side of the civil society or the citizens in general.
Maybe you would like to give light on the issue of, I mean, this regional force. Where are they coming from?
The force was said to be coming from the IGAD countries. And as the Voluntary Civil Society Task Force, we had reservations about this because of the fact that some of these countries have vested interest both in the conflict and in South Sudan. And so they cannot play an impartial role as the mandate of the United Nations would demand of them.
When is this force coming to Juba?
Of course.
When is it going to be deployed?
Of course, from the very beginning, the understanding was that the force would be deployed. Actually, by now, the force should have been in South Sudan. It's October now. The force should have been in South Sudan already. However, there are still discussions ongoing, and we have not gotten clear information on how many troops have been already mobilized, and then the logistic arrangements, deployment. And if you see from the Council of Ministers in Juba, they're talking about providing land for this force and so on. So it looks like it's still a process, because citizens even get confused, you know, in some of this. Just the other day, some of the citizens were running around demonstrating against this deployment, and also because they felt that was the position of the government, and the position suddenly changed. Of course, the citizens should note that politics or political statements are not cast on stone, but what is important here is the government should explain its position.
I want you to finalize on this position of the government, and what impact will it have on the implementation of the peace agreement indeed?
We should be able to ask the government and the SPLA to be able to speed up kind of providing the protection that the civilians need. So the SPLA needs to play a constructive role in protecting the people based on their mandates in the law, in the constitution. I think that needs to be taken up seriously, and that can be implemented. It doesn't require discussions and decisions from outside. This is a solution, that this decision that we can take in Juba and implement immediately with good positive results in Yei and the rest of these places.
Various government officials and donors have heard that peace is paramount for sustainable development in South Sudan. This was at the launch of an interim cooperation framework on Thursday. Our next story sheds more light on what the framework is and why it is important.
The United Nations country team in South Sudan, along with government leaders and other partners, have officially launched an interim development strategy for United Nations engagement in South Sudan. The Interim Cooperation Framework, or ICF, was developed and adopted jointly by all UN organizations operating in the country in consultation with their national and international partners. It consolidates UN agents' response over a two-year period from January 2016 to December 2017, which corresponds to the transitional period of the peace agreement. Speaking at the launch, the special representative of the Secretary General and head of the UN in South Sudan, Ellen Margaret Loy, said the framework should help chart a new course towards peace and prosperity.
Indeed, I hope that this event marks the start of a new, strong and fruitful partnership between the government of South Sudan, the donor community and the UN system. We are all aware that there is a significant amount of work to do to ensure a better future for the people of South Sudan after years of conflict and crisis. It's high time that we collectively chart a new course towards peace and prosperity for this country.
The Deputy Minister of Finance and Economic Planning, Mary Jarfasiak, welcomed the interim plan and pledged the government's commitment to work with the UN in its implementation.
We are satisfied to know that the ICF, with its five outcome areas, which we have just seen, is fully aligned with our priorities for the transitional period. And we welcome and look forward to the support of the agencies, funds and programs of the United Nations working together on this basis.
At the event, UN Humanitarian Coordinator in South Sudan, Ejun Owusu, also added his voice.
We are glad to have all of you here, as today's event represents a defining moment in the UN's collective efforts to support durable peace, to support recovery, and to support resilience building in South Sudan. Violence, displacement, poverty, hunger, multiple deprivations, and death. These are certainly not what Dr. John Garang fought for. And clearly, not what the martyrs of this country indeed died for. These are tragic outcomes that none of us can be proud of, and which the people of South Sudan certainly do not deserve.
The goal of the ICF is to support the transformation of South Sudan towards peace and stability and sustainable development by focusing on five highly prioritized substantive areas, namely enhancing the resilience of local communities, strengthening social services for the most vulnerable, strengthening peace and governance, reinvigorating the local economy, cross-cutting improvement in the status of women and youth. For this to be achieved, $900 million is required, and the funding will be mobilized from donors and international partners. I am Sani Martin, reporting for This Week.
After being turned back on the way to Lobonok, a team from the United Nations mission in South Sudan has gone ahead and handed over school material meant for a school in the area to Juba state officials. Dennis Loro brings you the following report.
Excellency, permit me to hand over this.
The United Nations mission in South Sudan on Tuesday handed over various education material meant for pupils of Sindiro Primary School in Lobonok to secretariat officials in Juba state. The items include 150 school bags, UNMISS branded t-shirts, 750 exercise books, and an assortment of pens, pencil, water bottles, and balls. Pupils of Sindiro Primary have been out of school since mid-August clashes between cattle keepers and farming communities. Parents and community members requested the material after fighting destroyed homesteads and forced children out of learning environments. The items which were handed over to the state authorities are inscribed with messages to promote peace and inculcate a culture of peace in the children. The United Nations official leading the team at the handover ceremony emphasized that the mission's contribution was also aimed at creating awareness among the school and community.
Some of these materials, the exercise book, for example, has peace messages. For example, it says, in conflict, protect schools, meaning that we should not destroy school materials during conflict, because the children are not the ones fighting, so we should leave their materials. There are some of the materials there too, like pencil, like all that, or pen. The pen, for example, has a peace message. The bag that we put, the things also have peace message. So when the children are reading and looking at this, we feel that awareness of peace will be created in their minds.
The UNMISS official said the UN will in future partner with other agencies and institutions to expand such interventions to other crisis-affected schools.
Education is a very important matter. The United Nations has agreed that sustainable development, number 4, is a key concept of development. And therefore, we should endeavor to make sure we have education. I believe what can actually propel education is peace. If we can have peace in South Sudan, not if we will have peace in South Sudan by the grace of God. It's not if we will have it. Yes. So when we have peace in South Sudan, education will be easier to fund, it will be easier to implement. Therefore, we are using the opportunity to also implore all parties to find a way to ensure that peace reigns in the Republic of South Sudan.
The State Minister for Education, Wane Sule, received the material and thanked UNMISS for the support.
We assure you that these school materials will be the responsibility of the State Ministry of Education, Jubeg State, to make sure that they reach the target that they are intended for. And for this, we assure you, and the Commissioner as well, that we will facilitate the transportation of some of these materials once the green light is given that the road is safe enough for us to reach here.
Following an integrated assessment mission to Lobonok at the end of August, another mission aimed at delivering material requested straight to the school at the end of September was prevented to proceed to deliver the material in Lobonok County. The team turned back at the Juba Bridge.
The United Nations Population Fund has this week been training its health providers and community health workers. Our next story highlights the importance of the training program.
In July this year, 100 separate cases of gender-based violence and rape against unarmed innocent civilians were recorded during conflict in South Sudan. Acknowledging and responding to the increased levels of cases of sexual violence, the United Nations Population Fund, UNFPA, have this week organized a 5-day course on clinical management of rape as part of their support services for gender-based violence survivors.
The purpose is to capacitate our provider, health providers, whether in the hospital, in the primary healthcare, about competencies and skills so that they can attend to women, adolescent girls, and even infants who have been victims of rape. This course is one of many that we are rolling out across the country with partners. Just 2 weeks ago, we did one in Wau. In 4 weeks, we will be conducting a training of trainers with the purpose of having more critical mass of people who can offer these services across the country here in South Sudan. The people in the courses are medical doctors, nurses, midwives, clinical officers, but also women who we use as community health workers so that they can help the women in the appropriate referral pathway.
UNFPA says that women are mainly victims of gender-based violence.
In any conflict, and in fact, in any humanitarian settings, women are usually victims of sexual gender-based violence. And particularly here in South Sudan with the prevailing conflict, we've had reports of rape and gender-based violence. So it is important that we make sure that these women, they have access to those services. That's why we are doing this course. This is not the first one that we are doing. Even last year, we've trained over 200 providers, but because of the turnover, you need to retrain people, and some of them train them for new competencies so that they can provide those services.
UNFPA is aiming to train 400 this year. Last year, they trained 200, and with more training programs scheduled, it is hoped that various women will be able to access the help they need in case they fall victim.
We want to make sure that they know what it entails, because some of them, that the first time they are even hearing about clinical management of rape, that's one. The second is when they have a case, how do they manage appropriately the case? We talked about the three C's: competencies, compassion, and confidentialities. Those are very key important things that we want them to get out of the course. Third and lastly, when there is a person with a case, for example, what are the supplies that you need to give them? For example, depends on the day that a woman comes to the services. How do you prevent an unwanted pregnancy? How do you prevent an HIV infection? So those have specific protocol with the product in the kit, and we hope that they will get those knowledge so that they can provide those services.
UNFPA is engaged in several activities at the community level to provide information on gender-based violence and make communities aware of what services are available.
Earlier, we brought you a story on the ASG for peacekeeping operations. Before he left the country, we asked Ghassim Wane what his hopes were for South Sudan. We leave you with what he said on our Voices of Peace. Goodbye for now, and we hope you'll join us again next week.
The South Sudanese themselves, who have suffered so much out of so many years, as a result of so many years of conflict, have for themselves, they want peace, they want reconciliation. I always remember I was in I believe in Malakal, and we met with a group of people, and when we asked them what they want, they said, we want peace like yesterday. And this is what the UN is for here. We want to work with the South Sudanese, with their leaders, to achieve peace in this country. And it is really high time that all silence the guns and embark on the path of inclusive dialogue, peace and reconciliation.